complete examination of the knee aims to determine the causation of pain and dysfunction in the knee region. The examination usually begins with observation and clearing of proximal and distal regions and is then followed by active, passive and resistant movements, which will further direct the palpation and special orthopedic tests to confirm or rule out suspected pathology. I'm now going to carry out a general knee examination.
Observation aims to assist in the general screening process of proximal and distal areas, as well as direct observation for unilateral or bilateral abnormalities to the affected knee joint. I usually begin observing from the anterior aspect and then view the patient from the side and the back. The frontal plane views help to determine imbalances or abnormalities in the frontal plane, such as trunk lean, spinal scoliosis, genu and coxa valgus and varus, and foot posture that may be affecting the knee joint. You can also get an indication of transverse plane abnormalities, such as increased torsion angle of the femur and femoral antiversion, by viewing the kneecap and femoral condylar positions and lower leg rotation by looking at the foot position in relation to the knee joint. These angles can also provide an indication of the Q angle as it affects the knee. The sagittal plane view from the side allows a view of general spinal lordosis and kyphotic postures, pelvic anterior and posterior rotation, and genu recuvatum at the knee. All angles allow for a bilateral comparison to include hypertrophy and atrophy, as well as other structural differences. The observation should cover general signs of injury such as bruising, discoloration, swelling, as may be evidence in a Baker's cyst or bursitis at the knee, and the presence of surgical scars. Observation can include some active components, reviewing of general lower limb proprioception on stable and unstable surfaces. If the athlete is involved in running sports, or if the symptoms are aggravated by walking and running, I usually perform a treadmill-based gait analysis to identify abnormal or problematic movement patterns. The gait analysis allows me to observe dynamic posture through the upper body and see how the lower limb is functioning through gait and how this may be affecting the knee. I begin with walking at 4.5 kilometres an hour and then move on to the running assessment. Initially, I look at the positions during heel strike and consider the hip, knee and ankle positions in the sagittal view. The foot position relative to the centre of mass upon heel strike will affect the ground reaction force and should be considered with bilateral comparison. Here we can see the relative ankle position on the left side, with bilateral comparison showing a slight overstride on the right hand side. I then want to look at peak hip extension that gives a good indication of dynamic glute function while observing how much hip extension we get without collapsing into an anterior pelvic tilt and losing lumbar pelvic stability. Lastly, in the sagittal plane, we can go on to look at peak hip flexion. Good hip flexion range will assist with knee flexion and prevent excessive knee extension at the point of ground contact, helping to manage the ground reaction force and dissipate the forces. The coronal plane view can test for dynamic Trendelenburg signs, looking at the stability of the lumbar pelvic and hip complex and the strength of the abductors. Positive or abnormal tests are recorded if the pelvis on the non-weight-bearing side drops because the gluteal muscles on the weight-bearing side cannot maintain the pelvis in a neutral position. Although the peak hip abduction is not diagnostic of a specific pathology at the knee, it can indicate reduced control and increased injury risk. From this angle, we also want to look for signs of a crossover gait, where the feet travel across the midline. Although pronation and supination are a natural part of gait, we do want to look at the athlete's ability to control the speed of the pronation, as this collapse may have detrimental effects proximally to the knee. If there is a suspected neurological component, I also test toe and heel walking, which will be difficult for a patient to do with neurological compromise. If subjective or early objective findings suggest a potential referral from the lumbar spine, hip region, or biomechanical causation from the lower leg, then a clearing screen should be completed of these areas. Neurodynamic tests check the mechanical movement of neurological tissues and their sensitivity to mechanical stress and compression. The slump and straight leg raise tests have progressive components to sensitize the neural tissue and monitor symptom reproduction. Hip clearing aims to detect a range of conditions that may be a source of referral symptoms, such as articular pathologies of FAI, labral tears, and hip joint instability. Ankle restrictions affecting the knee can be assessed through active movements with overpressure and through the weight-bearing lunge test. The weight-bearing lunge test measures either the maximal distance of the great toe to the wall or the tibial angle by inclinometer, with the heel remaining in contact with the floor whilst keeping sagittal plane alignment. Bilateral comparison of ankle dorsiflexion range is important for good knee function. A lack of dorsiflexion can lead to compensatory pronation that may then in turn lead to a medial collapse of the lower limb and affect knee alignment during gait. A quick bridge assessment, followed by a long bridge if they're capable, looking at the ability to maintain static posture, can help to screen for general kinetic chain weaknesses. Active movement assessment allows the practitioner to assess active range, control, muscle function, and patient willingness to complete the sagittal plane and horizontal plane movements available at the knee joint. These movements are then repeated in a passive physiological manner with the patient in a relaxed position. These usually have a slightly greater range than active movements as we test the anatomical barriers, and I'm looking for quality of movement through the range and the normality of the end feel. The movement should be compared bilaterally and with normative ranges. If joint pathology is expected, then I may go on to look at specific passive accessory movements or joint play to ascertain capsular and ligamentous restrictions or joint laxity. Resisted muscle testing compares strength of muscles or muscle groups in a neutral position to the unaffected side. Weakness may occur as a result of the knee injury or be a predisposing factor. If pathology to the musculotendinous structures or their osseous insertion is apparent, then pain and/or weakness will be present. Some compression to the inert tissues may occur, but should be kept minimal in an isometric contraction. This is measured using the Oxford grading scale. Palpation is directed by previous findings and should remain systematic using sound anatomical knowledge. Palpation looks for areas of maximal focal tenderness that can help differentiate between local structures. Soft tissue properties of resistance, muscle spasm, and tenderness should be assessed. I usually start anteriorly, running superior to inferior, with careful assessment of the joint line, including the collateral ligaments and superior tibiofibular joint, and to the soft tissues around the patella. Posteriorly, I put the knee into a flexed position with the patient prone to take the musculotendinous structures off stretch to assist with deeper palpation of the popliteal region. Light isometric holds can help to differentiate tendons and attachment sites at the back of the knee. As we work our way through the diagnostic sieve, orthopaedic testing is used to rule out or help confirm suspected pathology that remains part of the differential diagnosis. Very few tests can be used to conclusively rule in or out any particular condition, but they should be used to add to the index of suspicion, which will help inform your clinical reasoning process. I usually start with any additional myofascial length testing, including Ober's and Thomas test at the knee. With the athlete laying on the unaffected side, with the hip and knee flexed to provide a stable base. The affected limb is uppermost in a neutral position. The inability to reach 10 degrees beyond neutral without pelvic movement is considered abnormal. Variation with bent and straight knee can be used. To test for a fixed flexion deformity at the hip and assess muscle length of the rectus femoris iliacus, TFL and IT band, which may all factor into the injury causation, the Thomas test can be used. In the presence of soft tissue tightness or a fixed flexion deformity, the affected hip will be drawn into a degree of flexion, bringing the thigh away from the couch, although this may present as an increased lumbar lordosis. If the hip gravitates more towards abduction than flexion during the test, shortening of the ITB is likely. Passively exploring the end range available at the joint and assessing the end feel can help detect minor but significant differences. When reviewing the ligamentous stability of the knee, we should consider both intra- and extracapsular ligaments. The extracapsular ligaments can be tested using the valgus and varus stress testing. With the knee flexed to about 20 or 30 degrees, firm valgus or varus pressure is applied. The reproduction of medial or lateral knee pain suggests injury to the collateral ligaments. An intact ligament produces a normal ligamentous end feel where firm resistance to the stress is noted. Loss of this normal resistance and an increased movement in excess of 15 degrees suggests structural damage. Gapping of greater than 10 millimetres with a loss of definitive ligamentous end feel indicates a complete collateral ligament rupture. The posterior draw test has good likelihood ratio to detect posterior single plane instability and PCL laxity. Increased posterior translation of the tibia and associated loss of normal end feel, a step off noted between the anterior tibial plateau and the femoral condyles, are all positive signs. The anterior draw test is generally secondary to Lachman's in likelihood ratio, but can be used if Lachman's is equivocal. Lachman's is probably the most sensitive test for ACL, and is carried out in a range of about 10 to 30 degrees of knee flexion. Increased anterior translation of the tibia on the femur, with an accompanying change in end feel, usually indicates a significant injury. As with all tests, the range should be assessed bilaterally. Posterior lateral draw and external rotation recuvatum test can indicate posterior lateral rotary instability. Posterior translation or rotation of the lateral tibial condyle indicates PCL and LCL injury. In this test, hyperextension and varus, as well as increased external rotation of the tibia, would indicate positive findings.
Okay.
Reproduction of the patient's pain, clicking, or apprehension on McMurray's testing indicates a positive finding for meniscal pathology. If the ACL is normal, a combination of a block to full knee extension, positive McMurray's test, and pain on full flexion is highly suggestive of meniscal injury.
Yes.
The bounce home test can look for any apprehension or mechanical blockages in terminal knee extension.
Yes.
The use of Apley's compression appears to be declining due to the availability of more sensitive tests, but I find it useful as a secondary test for meniscal pathology. Pain and or apprehension elicited when rotation is applied under compression, which then reduces when the test is repeated with distraction, is a positive finding. The sweep test for the knee can help ascertain the presence of joint effusion. The test has good interrelator reliability, with positive tests indicated by a small wave or bulge appearing on the medial aspect of the knee. If the active, passive and resisted movements are performed with little difficulty, then a series of functional tests can be used, particularly for athletes whose sports include vigorous cutting, jumping, or rapid deceleration. I often use the single leg drop landing test. This test shows up instabilities and control issues that may predispose an athlete to injury. We're looking for an appropriate absorption of load through the ankle, knee, and hips, with alignment in the sagittal plane. Looking for knee valgus and ankle pronation collapse to assess dynamic abductor function and lower limb neuromuscular control. We can also see more proximally at the torso. With the simple landing technique training, we can see how this athlete can be easily improved. which is clearly associated with a reduction in non-contact ACL injuries.